Herzlich willkommen zum letzten Talk heute schon an Tag 1 im Hexenstream. Dieser Talk wird von Blinry und Bleeptrack gehalten, und zwar, das ist Operation Mindfuck bereits zum fünften Mal in dieser Formation. Hier ist besonders, dass das Q&A zum Talk gleichzeitig stattfindet in unserem Raum, der gerade eingeblendet ist, also auf events.hex.org/asam_ada. Aber der Talk startet, das Q&A startet erst in ein paar Minuten. Der nächste Talk ist auf Englisch, daher das gleiche nochmal für unsere englischen Zuhörer. Welcome back to the Hexen Channel, and this is the last talk for today, Operation Mindfuck, Volume 5 by Blinry and Bleeptrack. The Q&A to this session will be at the same time as the talk, so you can watch the talk and ask questions already in our big blue button. The link to the big blue button is shown below, and you also have a QR code where you can follow and go to the link. It's events.hexen.org/asam_ada.html, and the session will start in a few minutes. Of course, you can also ask questions on Twitter and Mastodon on the usual Hexen channels. And now, have fun with the talk.
Everyone, we are back. We are Bleeptrack and Blinry, and we are super excited to give another talk of our series Operation Mindfuck, where we want to nerd snipe you a little bit. We will show you a lot of different little topics from computer science, mathematics, art, culture, what everything that comes to our mind and that is on our interest list and that we collected over the last year, I'd say. And this will, maybe take 40 minutes to an hour, maybe. And after that, we will have the chance to do a little Q&A. And this is a recording, so you can also join the link, big blue button that you will find somewhere in the schedule. And we will also we will be there live when the recording plays. And you can also ask us questions there if you want. And I'd say, let's just start, right?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
The first topic we've prepared for you is about fantasy consoles, which are consoles that have like a little bit of retro charm. They have like a low resolution and some serious hardware restrictions, but they are not actually implemented in hardware. They are just a piece of software that feel like they would be like a retro console. And one fantasy console I really like is called TIC-80. When you boot it up, it looks like this. It greets you with a little color message and a command line. And you can do things like saving and loading games there. And you can already see that like we are quite limited in terms of resolutions. The font is quite pixely. And if we type help spec, we can get the specification of this fantasy console. It has like this resolution, it has a limited amount of space for storing graphics, it has 4-channel sound, and this is for me a really nice playground to make games in, because like if you have this limitation, it sometimes makes it easier to come up with ideas, because you cannot do everything and you have to work inside of these restrictions. And TIC-80 is nice because it has some built-in tools for making games. If you press escape, you can get to some of these editors, like the code editor, where you can program in scripting languages like Lua or Ruby or JavaScript. You have a built-in sprite editor, so you can make little pixel graphics. You can also see the default 16 color palette down there. You have a built-in map editor, you can make sound effects, like setting the waveform in this area here, and then saying that the volume should decrease over time, and then you can play on the keyboard and make some jumping sounds. And especially you can combine these sounds in the music editor by clicking on these buttons to have some notes, and then it will play top-down. I think this is neat that this is also integrated in TIC-80, so you don't have to leave this environment and go somewhere else, use some external tools to to make the assets, but you can just stay in this fantasy world and work inside of its constraints. If you want to dive a little bit deeper, like closer to the hardware, the virtual hardware of this console, you can look at the RAM layout. Similar like old hardware things like Commodore 64, it's very well defined where things go in the memory. So you exactly know when the game loads where the sprites are stored, for example. You have access to the video RAM, so you can directly put some information there to put things on screen if you want. That's like a bit of a trick sometimes. And what's really fun is to just load a game and then add a little bit of code that fills all of this memory with random bits, and then your game kind of glitches over time, and it's really nice. In the beginning of this month, I took a little challenge to make 50 little programs and take 80. Let's see if we can play this. Yeah, there's like a little fireworks animation for the last program because I was so exhausted and happy that I made it through. And these showcase some of the things you can do with Tick 80. If you're interested in checking that out, you can find both here. And if you want to learn more about Tick 80, you can go to the website. It has some documentation. Yeah, I really recommend checking it out. At this point, a shout out to another fantasy console, which is, to my knowledge, the console that coined the term fantasy console. It's called Pico 8. And it's even more constrained. So, like, you can see the specs here. It has a display of 128 by 128 pixels. And it's also really cute and fun. But in comparison to Tick 80, this is not open source. So you cannot do pull requests for it. So, yeah. Yeah, over to you, Ina.
Yeah, thanks. And oh man, I liked your Twitter thread with your 50 little coding experiments so much. It was, yeah, I was enjoying that so much watching this over this whole weekend grow piece by piece, and everything, every new thing you tried out was so fun. Yeah, like everyone check this thread out. It's so cool. All right, I think a thing I'd like to talk about is differential growth. So I do a lot of generative art stuff. Now I can say not only in my free time, but now also as a freelance person. yeah, and this year I had some spare time where I wanted to try out some very typical or very well-known generative art algorithms that for some reason I never touched because I thought they were too complex, too funky for me, or maybe not fitting my style. And two of them I'd like to show you today. And the first one is differential growth. And you can find differential growth structures in nature a lot. For example, in certain types of, especially in plants, in certain types of flowers, like in sea anemone? I don't know, like where the clownfishes live. Everyone has seen Finding Nemo, I guess. And these structures usually emerge from certain, yeah, growing patterns or growing constraints. And this is a very nice collage, I'd say, I took from Nervous Systems. Please check out their work and website. They do great stuff, and I will also show you a video from them afterwards. And yeah, this is where you can find it in nature. So to code this, usually it's a rather complex system that consists of several steps. So you can imagine like the structure or like that wavy structure consists of several points that are somehow connected through straight lines or through Bezier curves, for example. And each of these points, they are in some way attracted to each other. You need to do some sort of alignment. So if every point moves in a certain direction around point X, this point has to align to the movement of the other points. And also you have a sort of repulsion. So you don't want to get the, you don't want to let the points grow too narrow. So these three, like attraction, repulsion, yeah, constraints need to work together in a very yeah, certain nice specific way that this growth pattern emerges. And the last thing you usually do is a sort of subdivision. So when two points get too far away from each other, you will insert a new node, a new point there. And then on this point, you you put the same rule set. But I found a very nice write-down from Caspar Ravel, and sadly, it's not online anymore. I'm not sure if he will put it online. Again, if you, for some reason, watch this talk, please put your write-up again online. And I think you can maybe find it in the Google Cache or Wayback Machine or something. It is amazing. And he has a very reduced version of differential growth, which only uses two things. The subdivision basically stays the same, so with 2 points, travel away too far, you will insert a new point. And then all the other rules, he condenses down to the repulsion part. So when 2 points every point will repulse other points, but in an exponential way. And this is a very, very clever way to do it, because now you have, because of the exponential way he describes, the repulsion only is constrained to a rather fixed area, and in an indirect way you have the attraction still going through that exponential function. That's quite nifty. And when you code this, it looks something like this. I put this into like few lines of Paper.js code, and it looks very interesting if you let that grow. So I started like with 5 points, and now you can see it's growing. At the beginning, it looks like it's growing a lot, and then it sort of gets slower because it will never find a stable. It will never be a stable system. It will always grow in some sort, but it's getting a lot slower. But it's very fascinating to look at. That's the video I wanted to show you. It's also from Nervous Systems, and they apply basically the same rules to a 3D system. And yeah, it's so exciting to see. And they will also show a lot of different versions with different parameters or different constraints. Yeah, you can hear the silence. It's mesmerizing to watch. And yeah, I think it's also it's such a nice way to have a very organic structure. And the thing you just saw is also a fun thing to do for 3D printing objects. So you can put the exponential growth in a 2D space, and for every iteration, you give it a new layer in 3D space, and this also emerges very interesting and lets emerge very interesting 3D sculptures to print. Very fun. So yeah, that's the video. Please check out Nervous Systems. They're doing amazing work. They make great write-ups of the stuff they do, and I think they use it often to sell like jewelry, or they 3D print huge lamps in these structures. It's really cool. Really cool to watch. All right. Let's go to the next topic.
I think they even do 3D printed clothing, right? Like dresses.
Yeah, they do. That's a whole different game. That's exciting. Yeah, I think, I could talk about that for hours. Yeah. But they have one thing maybe on that. They have a cool video where they show where they 3D printed a dress, and the dress was too big to 3D print it on as a single piece laid flat. So they made computed the dress in a way that it fits. It's folded and fits in a little box. And then they take the dress out of the printer and like shake it up, and then this cool dress falls out from the hands. Yeah, super, super cool. Yeah, search for that video. That's really amazing.
You mentioned that the 2D version of what you just showed can be implemented in a few lines of code, right? Which kind of plays into our next topic, which is size coding. Just kind of the art of making interesting, creative stuff happen in little code. You might have heard of the demo scene, which is this subculture of computer artists, I would say, who really like to create programs that make some nice graphics and music, like a few minutes of a music video, basically, but created by a program. And sometimes people from the demo scene meet at places called demo parties, where they basically show off and show stuff to each other and also have competitions around these things. And one competition format is a restriction to have a program that is not larger than 4 kilobytes, which is like basically 15 tweets of code. And then these programs can do really amazing things at this point. I have an example from 2 years ago. It's a demo called EisenErz by LG and Virgil. And like it starts with a slow fade in. You have some fog and fires. And there's this river of lava flowing down there. And you have this structure and some chains and this logo on the wall and rocks at the sides. And you float through this by the camera. And you also have a music track, which sounds really nice. And yeah, all of this is done in 4 kilobytes. And this is really black magic for me. This, you can see this goes for 2.5 minutes. It's really, really neat. There are a lot of tricks to like squeeze stuff into this size. Some automated tools that help with this, but also just some, it's a matter of technique, right? You cannot store any of this geometry in the program. You have to generate it on the fly as the program runs. And if you find this as fascinating as me, definitely check out the demo scene. You can find a lot more of this there. Let's go down a bit further to one tweet. I found a few weeks ago a really neat game jam where the task is to code a game where the source code fits into 280 bytes. It's called the Tweet Jam. It has been repeated a few times over the years. You can also take a look at the submissions. And for me, this is a really entertaining format because like 280 characters of code, basically you cannot do a lot. You have to really think about what you want to convey, what you want to happen on screen. And then people take this challenge and come up with programs that are basically a Tetris implementation or a little grid-based puzzle game. And I think that's pretty amazing. This is also a format, I think, where the fantasy consoles from the last section really shine. For example, I made a TIC-80 program that looks like this. It fits in a tweet. And because this is Lua, you can like use some tricks to omit line breaks if you don't need them. The Lua parser works in a way where it knows that this here cannot be a variable because they cannot start with numbers. So it knows it must, like a new command must start at this position. And you can do tricks like setting aliases, like this Z here, that is basically an alias for this circle function now, and we can call it a bunch of times. And if you run this in TIC-80, you get this animation. Let's see if I can maybe play this. You have these little pink colored balls, and they are very happy and like look at your mouse cursor and like jump excitedly as you stroke them. This was really fun to make. Even further down, and back to the demo scene, there's a popular format of 256 bytes. And people in the demo scene seem really to like MS-DOS executables for this format, because there, I think it's really easy to like evoke a graphical environment, like set a graphics mode and then start pushing some pixels on the screen. Here's a demo in that size from last year by Helmut. And it just shows you like a sequence of, I think, 7 or 8 different animations, which start to blend into each other. You have these geometric patterns. You have 3D scenes like this one here. Some fractals. We fly through a tunnel. And for me, this is, again, really amazing. Helmut did a really nice write-up on how they came up with this and how this works. So check this out. This also has a music track. I think on DOS, you somehow can play MIDI notes. So that's a trick they use to make a little rhythmical music in the background. This is a demo party specific to like size coding in the small formats called Love Byte. The next one is in February of next year. So check it out if you're interested in this. If we go down to half a tweet, 140 bytes, there's a site called Dritter, where the challenge is to code like really small JavaScript programs, like this one down here. And this is neat because it gives you some predefined variables, like X is an HTML canvas context, and then you can use it to draw geometric things. People do amazing stuff there. You have like some social media features like liking and taking something else and remixing it. Yeah. And finally, if we go to 32 bytes, there's a website called tixi.land. It works a bit similarly. You have this canvas of circles. And the way it works is that you have a JavaScript function that is evaluated for each of these circles. And you have as an input, t is the time in seconds, I think. I is the index of the circle, and x and y are its coordinate. So for each circle, you evaluate this. If it outputs a 1, you have a really big white circle. And if you like make it smaller, the circle shrinks down to 0. And if you have a negative 1, you get a red circle. And using this, and now try to make patterns. Right, if you take the x coordinate and divide it by 16, because it's the number of circles in a line, you get this gradient, and then you can start doing things like doing something with the time, so it shifts, or maybe using some of the other components to make little animation. Tixi.land, if you visit that site, it has a lot of examples, and yeah, for me, it's also a really fun format to play with size coding. If you find any formats that are even less than 32 bytes, please let me know. I would be really interested in seeing what you can do with that.
The next little thing I like to show you is, it's a really quick thing. It's also more of a cool tool that I found, and it's about I swapped it already away, about neural cellular automata. That's a very interesting concept that I stumbled upon, I think, on Twitter last year or this year. And it's neural net that is trained on certain images, but not like, as you can imagine it with a GAN, but more in a way that each pixel represents a cell, and each cells or like connected cells talk to each other and do some information swapping. And these cells try to recreate the image. But the fun part is that each cell doesn't know a lot about the whole image, but more about its surroundings. And you can do a lot of fun stuff with that. And the authors of the paper made this cool generator of some sort. So you can choose some of these textures to start with, and the cells will then like try to recreate this image. And you can see it's not like a one-to-one recreation, but it's more like it grasps the sort of the concept of the texture and recreates that. So let's try that out. And you can see that depending on the texture, there's a lot of shifting in time. So some of these versions don't really get into a stable final image, but instead they will start, or they will keep floating around and start, keep moving. And that's super fun to watch. And you can play around with that a lot. Let's try another one. Maybe this one is also very, very cool to look. Looks a bit like the leaf veneation pattern thing I showed some years ago. And this is one of the examples where you can see that the concept of the initial image, this cobweb down here, is not really caught. So it loses like this cobweb structure and only has the more local information represented in here. But let's fiddle a bit more with that one. You can also change the way the cells are connected. Like currently, the selection I have is like a straight line connection, but you can also put this into this circle arrangement, and then you can see that the structure changes towards the middle. And you can also have a version where you have like more of the swirls. And this, I think there was a nice pattern where you could even see this better. I think it was this one. Yeah, that's a nice one where you can see like the centers where the cells move towards to or are connected from. And yeah, you can also like play around with the speed a bit. So it's the iterations are going faster or slower. And you can also do fun things with the rotation. So let's go back to this single center one. And then you can introduce some sort of rotation. And then you get very funky swirls. And it's super cool to grow. And these are the segment with textures and inception. When I'm right is a different way they introduce the picture. So inception basically uses another neural net to introduce the picture to the neural net, to the cellular neural net. Yeah, it's really a lot of fun to play with that. Go with that. The grid type, for a grid type, I will show you a different example. And if you want to know more on how this works, this is basically just the playable version of the paper. And very luckily, they put just the whole paper below that. So you can like very deep dive into the whole concept of this nice generator. A lot of cool examples also. And a lot of fun. So I have to quickly jump back because I didn't put it in a nice way in our slides. But also there's this the second one here, and this does basically the same thing with grid cells. So you don't you don't have a regular grid with pixels, but you have like hex cells, so they are connected in a hexagonal structure, and you can also see like the hexagons have different sizes, so it's like not a uniform world. It's more like it's shifting to smaller hexagons on one side. Now, this is very interactive. You can now introduce noise into this world. You can also see that it wraps. So when I move my mouse here and insert the noise, you can see that the same noise bubble will emerge in different spots. And yeah, and when you introduce noise and yeah, remove your mouse, you will see the cells reconstruct the structure. And that's very fun to just like doodle in and see what new shapes emerge. And if you get tired of that pattern, just do a swipe left or right, and it will swap over to a different template pattern. Ooh, that's a fun to draw. And I don't think I flipped through all of the patterns that are in there, but it's very fun. And you can, if you want to try that out yourself, because the links are not that very nice, rememberable, maybe. You can find it on our slides. We will give you a link to our slides at the end of the talk. And then you can go ahead and paint your own fun neural cellular doodles.
So mesmerizing. I haven't said that in a long time, but I would really like to have this as a screensaver or something.
Man, yeah, that would be good. Not sure if I would go back to work. I would just sit in front of the screen and say, yeah, that's fine. I'm done.
Next up, I want to talk about the mirror paradox and like the three phases I went through when I like looked into this topic. The mirror paradox is usually stated as, why do mirrors swap left and right, but not up and down? And like intuitively, this seems like a strange situation. But like back when I first heard this paradox, this was like phase one for me. I heard it resolved in the following. Mirrors don't really swap left and right. They don't really care about any axis in particular. They swap front and back. Right. Let's look at an example. We have this little robot in front of a mirror. And if we think about like this front and back swapping is true, because like each point on its body is just opposite in the reflection, right? The head is still up, just opposite on the other side of this image, this mirror plane, basically. If you look at the hand, it's also just on the other side and opposite. Each point works like that. So for me, it seemed pretty clear that this was a nice resolution of this paradox, and I didn't think about it much more. But then I got thinking, if this robot would like look at a photograph of itself and then compare that with the image it sees in the mirror, there is something weird going on there, right? Because the head in the photograph is up, and in the mirror it's up. But the raised hand, for example, in the photograph, if it always has that had the hand raised, in the photograph it would be like on the right side, and looking in the mirror it is on the left, definitely. So there is some difference in axes there, and this is for me phase two, the confusion phase. Before like I did some research and like tried to find what's the trick behind that, what's going on, why does this mirror work that way, and yeah, in reality, it's not really about the mirror. It's about the way the robot, like, or we as people turn towards mirrors. If we imagine, like, looking at this robot from the front, just as observers, we would see the hand on the right side raised, right? And then the thing that happens is that the robot turns towards the mirror on its vertical axis, on the up-down axis. And that's basically the place where this swapping happens. And I have another graphic to demonstrate that. We have this little lucky cat here, and like an outside observer looks at this cat, like this version A of it, and it sees, okay, this hand on the one side is raised. But then like the cat turns towards the mirror on the up down axis, and now these sides are flipped. Like both looking at the reflection in the mirror and looking at the cat that has just turned, the raised paw is now on the other side, while the head is still up and the feet are still down. And that's basically because of the way like our physics work, right? We have gravity going down, and because of that, it's very easy for us to turn on that axis. So this is a special axis for us. And that's usually the way we would turn towards something like a mirror and turn away from an observer. If this was a very artistic cat, maybe, for example, and it would do, like, from this position, do a backflip and then look in the mirror upside down, it would be different. In that case, like, the paw would stay on that side if it would flip on its head. But now the up and down things would be swapped. Like, the observer would see both in the mirror and in the flipped version of the cat, the head would now be at the floor. Yeah, just wanted to share these three phases with you. I really hope that I will get to a fourth confusion phase and I can think about this some more.
Yeah, flow fields are the second very well-known thing in the generative art scene that I never touched before for some reason. And to be honest, they are very fun to play with. And they, yeah, let emerge. Yeah, I mean, the name already gives away a bit how it works. So you have like very smooth flowing lines, and they are generated from a field, actually from a vector field. So you have like a grid of vectors that point in a certain direction, and you start... Oh, yeah, you can see my mouse. And you start at some point and follow along basically these vectors. And if you connect them, you will get very nice lines, very smooth, curvy movements. So it's actually quite simple. And the easiest way, for example, to fill these vector fields is with Perlin noise, which already is a very nice organic noise. Or if you don't want to use Perlin, there's also simplex noise, also very similar. And then you can just grab the noise value and decide on a rotation of the vector depending on the noise. So that's a very easy, quick thing to fill in such vector fields. And so this is my very first test that I did with that. So it's a simplex noise vector field. And if you just start on a random position and draw as long as you can until you reach the end of the image. That's the pattern that emerges here. But one thing to note maybe is that it looks like I'm drawing from the inside to the outside the lines, but that's vice versa, from the outside to the inside, but that's actually not true. So all I'm doing is I take random points in the image and they basically flow out. And it's fun to see that, for example, on the left side, the streams forms where all of the lines like start to grow together and find that same path. And I think that's very nice to do maybe procedural generation if you want to do something like riverbeds, like where different streams from mountains will come together in the same riverbed and then start to flow together. And what you can also do is like take this algorithm, but also not draw in the direction the vectors are pointing, but also in the different direction, 180 degrees different direction. So you get like longer connected lines that don't stop in the way they do here. And this is something that looks like that. And this is even more like riverbeddy looking, I'd say. And these are only the forms you can easily achieve with Perlin or simplex noise. But of course, you can get crazy on how you fill these vector fields or how you create these vector fields. And I will show you some examples of that. That was another very quick experiment I did. If you say you don't like start on random points on your canvas and instead like take a light as starting points, you can, for example, get these shapes. And they look a bit more fancy and distinguished maybe. It's also fun to experiment with different ways to start. And Tyler Hobbs does a lot of work with vector fields, and he has a very great write-up and comparison website where he tries different parameters on different versions and documents how the outcomes look like. And for example, here, the only difference is that he changes the length of the strokes that he draws. So on the left side, a small has a bit of a texture quality, like maybe a bit of short fur looking, and the right side is already very wavy, looks a bit like maybe more like long hair or like could also be like a grass bed or something. Very interesting. So this is just changed the line length, basically. And there's also a little comparison on where you start with your strokes. So the things that I did all started on random points, but you can also say like you start on a grid and then you get these very synthetic looking images. Or I'm not exactly sure how he did the circle packing actually, but that's maybe a thing to look up at his write-up. But go crazy and experiment with starting points. I've also seen very nice examples where people like take certain shapes where they start off and you can still see the shapes where it comes from, but it gets distorted a bit. It's also very cool. And then this is my very big favorite from Tyler Hobbs, where he does some artificial distortion on the noise. And then you get these like crooked looking shapes that are a bit between like, I don't know. For me, it looks a bit like if you have tree roots that grow on pave walks, for example, and they have to like grow around some edges or some stones or something. That's a bit like the form that emerges here. It's a weird mixture from organic shapes and very artificial edgy shapes. Very fun to do that. And the last slide here is where I try to implement it in a 3D way. So the line, like the wavy lines you can see are also flow fields, but in a 3D space. And sorry, it's so choppy because my laptop was a bit too weak to record that in a smooth way. But for also the library I'm using here is Blurry. That's a very nice JavaScript add-on for Three.js that does a nice rendering, which gives you the look of like macro photography, where you have a lot of nice blurred background. It's a lot of fun to use. And yeah, 3D flow fields can also be a lot of fun. So yeah, go for it, experiment with it, because it's like literally two lines of code to make cool wavy stuff, and then you can have days of fun experimenting with that.
I know that like usually the things you showed were probably done on purpose, right? People had some idea in mind and then maybe tried around a bit, but then more or less the programs did what they wanted to, I guess. In this section, I want to go into some pieces of art where there was some unexpected and accidental glitch, basically. Many years ago, when I was in university, I was working with a friend on an assignment in a computer graphics course. And we had this assignment of like drawing a 3D bunny on the screen. There's this standard 3D model of, I think it's called a Stanford bunny. It just defines its vertices and how they are connected to form a mesh. And we were like practicing using OpenGL to render that to the screen. And we did something wrong. I have no idea what. We connected the vertices in some weird way and we got this image. And you can kind of still see the shape of the bunny. So its ears are kind of up here and this is its face, but it's like all covered up in this bizarre looking colored shapes. And it's totally not what we wanted to do, but I was like, I looked at it and thought, it looks looking pretty nice. Took a screenshot, later called it the Stanford iceberg and didn't really think much of it. But then later I found that this happens so often that it's worth it to like start collecting those accidental art pieces. And I wanted to show you some of those. I set up a website called the Glitch Gallery, which exhibits these art pieces and a little description on what went wrong, basically. For example, this is a piece that happened to Laura when she was implementing C3 NAV. Maybe you remember back then when we were doing in-person events, there was the software used to like draw maps of the event venue. And there was some rendering error apparently, and it got this really nice abstract art piece with cool looking gradients. I thought that was cool. This is a piece by Rami. I think it was a photograph of a galaxy, and Rami tried to filter it to blur it out. And the filtering algorithm had some weird bug that caused a lot of like overflowing integers, I imagine. So now instead of like a filtered galaxy photo, we have a galaxy smoothie. And this one here was submitted to the Glitch Gallery by Manuela when she was working in a game engine. And what happened here is that she accidentally dragged a material that was supposed to be used for rendering text to a tree object, to the leaves. And then you have these this letter tree. She titled this a poem as lovely. And I think it's really nice. And yeah, if you now think, oh, I have this happened to me as well. I have this screenshot of this old bug that happened when I was trying to do something completely different. You can go to glitchgallery.org and submit it if you want, and add a little description of what happened. Like think of a very artsy title or something, and I would be very happy to exhibit it there.
Yeah, let's stay with art. So I want to tell a little story that happened to me last year, and it ended in a very nice generator. that's too long, didn't read. From anger to art. So yeah, I mentioned it before, but with the starting of 2021, I began to freelance as a creative technologist. And well, you all know Corona happened, and it actually sucks quite a lot, especially if you want to do museum exhibitions and stuff. And that's the reason why in all around Germany, some sort of helping funds popped up. And I am situated in the south of Germany, in Bavaria. So for me, it was interesting to see the Bavarian Help Fund for artists. And they actually had one that applied to me for extra for young artists. And I was very happy when they announced it in October 2020 that they will provide a help fund with actually quite a lot of money, 5,000 euros for each applicant. And there were a lot of free spots to apply to. And they said, yeah, in the very beginning of 2021, in January, you can apply, you will get your money, all is fine. And of course, nothing happened in January. So I waited 3 more months and still nothing happened. And that's the point where I began to be quite angry. So I did a little art piece and also a little video on that. So it says in October 20, this art fund was, put out, nothing was paid yet. You can't even apply now. And this is why I did a little artsy project. It's quite a complex image, but the details will explain everything. Thanks for nothing. So as you can see, I did a little generator that creates a lot of little angry fingers. And it was very fun to code, actually. I guess there's a broken video here, which would have shown you the pen plotter plotting, maybe not that interesting, but here's a little animation and how the whole process works. So it's a one-line drawing, so it's easier with the pen plotter to draw. And then I can swap around some parameters, the length, some shapes. I also wiggle around the points that it's more organic. And then I can also play with the Bezier handles to give different bendings. And in the last step, I throw in some very, popping colors and angry edges to give it a bit more of a punky look, maybe. And it was a very fun project. I also printed a lot of stickers, but also another thing happened. So in July, 9 months after they proposed the project and 6 months, half a year after it should have been given to people, I got a phone call that I was selected from to be one of 10 young artists to get the help money in a ceremony. And I was quite confused because I thought, like, why do they do this weird ceremony to give out help money? But okay, I don't know. It's like maybe politics and they can do some PR stuff for their politics. So I said, yeah, I'd like to get the money. I will come. This is how I ended up standing beside the minister, Bavarian Minister for Culture and Arts, Mr. Siebler, and receiving this nice diploma telling me, yep, you got your scholarship. That's what they ended up calling it. It's now a scholarship. It's not, it stopped to be some sort of help money. It's now a scholarship for some reason. And as far as I know, today, some people still have not heard back and still have not received help money. And I'm, for some reason, one of the lucky 10 people who were used for their PR campaign to get the money. But I thought, yeah, that's nothing. That's fine with me. So I made some little scenes about the whole situation and about this project. It's called Funky Fingers. And inside it has one little generative sticker, and it explains that it's a project that was created from anger and disappointment. And if you have to wait 5 months for your help fund, it's not a help fund. It's a PR stunt. And people should put the stickers where they want and also wear a mask. That's what the scene basically says. And well, when we did the gathering to get the this scholarship form. We had to take a lot of photos, and my first idea was to give it out to like the scenes, to give them out to press, but sadly because of Corona, I guess, they did not invite any press, so there was only the house press there. So the last chance I saw to put this out publicly was to hold it in the photo when they did the official photo. So now you can see a very angry tiny finger in the official photo that they did for this whole project. Oh, well, but yeah, the generator also has very strong opinions on certain topics. And if there is an opinion this generator should reflect on, you can also do a pull request if you want, and we can add a bit more text. If you want to try that generator, go to fuck.bleeptrack.de. It's open source. It's online. You can use it for everything you want. Feel free and have fun.
The last topic we are going to cover today is about a programming language called APL. APL is an acronym that stands for literally a programming language. It was designed in the 60s, and it's like it looks like mathematical notation. It's very close to that. And it's notable because it allows you to write super concise, short programs. That seems to be a theme today, I don't know. So APL has a list of, like, here's a list of operators. It has some, like, some common ones like addition or comparisons. APL works very well with multidimensional arrays. So, like, if you take an addition operator and put arrays on both sides, you will get the component-wise additions on both sides. And then there's also some really nice high-level operators, like the two dots here, for example, are an each operation. Or the slash here, like, is a higher order function that modifies another function. So if you write plus slash, the slash will modify the plus. So now it no longer applies to both sides, but it looks at the array on the right and adds all the elements inside of it. So it's what other languages would call a reduce operation, the slash. And yeah, these are some really weird looking characters in there for the operators. Back when the language started to get popular, the company maintaining it sold actual keyboards containing those characters. I love how like futuristic and alien-like these keys sound, these keys look. And yeah, by now, all of them are also in Unicode. And most often, you will have some software environments that have shortcuts defined to type them. I wanted to show you my three favorite operators of APL. There's one called the domino, which takes a matrix and inverts it. I think that's nice. There's the fire hydrant operator that takes a string and then executes it as APL commands. And yeah, my one type, like my single most favorite operator in APL is this one that looks like a little confused face. I love it so much. It's a commute function. It's another like higher order function, and it modifies the function in front to swap its two operands around. And sometimes that helps you to write in a more concise way. Back when I was in the Recurse Center 2 years ago, I like looked into this language and started learning it a little bit. And there is this like standard programming exercise called FizzBuzz, which is basically like outputting the list from the numbers 1 to 100. But if the numbers are divisible by certain numbers, you replace the numbers by the words fizz or buzz or both of them. And this was my first attempt at doing an APL implementation. This was really like, yeah, I don't know, really convolved and unnecessarily complex. So the second try looks like this. It uses the IOTA operator to like create a list from the numbers from 1 to 100, once in each, and then interpiles this function. And then like basically checks for divisibility of the number we are currently iterating through. The divisibility of these three numbers, takes the first index where this was divisible and uses it as an index into this array, which either selects one of the words we want to output or the number itself. So yeah, just to give you an impression on how APL programs can look like. Here's a more complex one, implementing Game of Life. It's this cellular automaton. Bine, you talked about that in Operation Mindfuck Volume 2. If you're interested, you can check it out there.
Oh yeah, right.
It's this like moving pattern that's really like doing really interesting things. And yeah, this is how you can implement it in APL. I have no idea how this works. I didn't write this. This is from an explanation video. And if you want to learn how it works, check it out in the slides. If you want to try APL, there's actually a website called tryapl.com where you can like have an interactive interpreter of it and also some documentation and all the operators at the top if you want to type them by clicking on them. And to have like a really nice short introduction to APL at Enthusiasticon 2019, Phoebe did a talk on APL, and this is like a 16-minute intro to like the most common features and operators. And I think that's a really good like entrance to this whole rabbit hole. Yeah. That's all we have for today. You can find the slides at this link. And if you missed any of the previous Operation Mindfuck volumes, here's a list of which topics we covered when and where you can find the recordings. For today, thanks a lot for listening and coming to this talk. A lot of content we create is released under like open licenses. If you want to support us in doing that, we have Patreon pages where you can throw coins at us if you want. We're really grateful for the people who do. And with that, I would say enjoy the rest of RC3 and see you around.
Bye. See you around. Bye.